everybody. I'm Crandall.
I'm Mercy.
We are Armchair Directors.
Please look up and to the right.
Taking a look at Denis Villeneuve's Blade Runner 2049, a sequel 30 years in the making.
It sucked.
Which...
I'm kidding.
This is a really polarizing movie because...
Because idiots don't appreciate good movies.
It's 2 hours and 45 minutes long, which is daunting to a lot of people when they hear that out of the gate. Blade Runner itself was a very challenging movie that a lot of people will fall in between, love it or hate it. And Villeneuve takes over. Ridley Scott didn't direct this. He produced it. And what they do is they jump ahead so many years.
30.
From till 2049.
But they fill it in with those three prequel
shorts. And basically...
Did you
recaptures? I did, yeah. I thought they were fine.
Watch those. I think they're absolutely necessary.
Recaptures the essence of Blade Runner while making Blade Runner integral to the events of this movie in a way that makes Blade Runner better by doing so. And finds a way with our modern special effects and stuff to still feel like the same aesthetic of the old Blade Runner, but with all this modern stuff and just jaw-droppingly gorgeous cinematography, amazing special effects, and a great moody soundtrack that sells all this stuff. And they've got a great leading man in Ryan Gosling who really brings it in this role.
I want to mention the music before we move on. Like, there's even sound effects that sound like they're part of the soundtrack, or maybe they are part of the soundtrack and they just integrated it with sounds in the movie, like the cars.
Yeah,
that sounds like the soundtrack.
But it does.
I think it's the cars taking off and landing. But what happens if you take the stunning visuals of the first movie and add a story that actually matters? You get Blade Runner 2049, and that's another reason I say you got to watch them back to back with the prequel movies shorts in between, because altogether it's a great story, and Blade Runner is just as important a piece of 2049's story as anything else is. So this is going to be a spoiler review, because we're going to talk about the actual movie here. And I want to jump a little bit ahead to Harrison Ford's involvement in this movie.
Yeah.
So I was excited about this movie. This was maybe the only movie I was excited about all of 2017. And the one thing that I had a little bit of trepidation about was, oh my God, is Harrison Ford on a so long tour.
Right.
Killing off all of his
classic great characters.
And I was just really happy that, not that Deckard didn't die, I don't care if he dies, but that he was used with such reverence, such importance, that he wasn't a background character. He doesn't show up until halfway through the movie.
They do make you wait for him, though.
Yeah, which is perfect. They should have, because it's building up. And if he had been there immediately or in the first 10 minutes, it wouldn't have had the same impact.
Yeah, it would have lessened it.
So this is how you do it. I mean, it's so rare that I watch a movie and I learn something, or I go, I wouldn't have done it that way, but you're right, you know, or that's better than the way I would have done it. So I love the restraint that they had. We have Ford, but we're going to wait. And then to use him so minimally, but it didn't feel like I didn't get enough Deckard in the movie either. Like, he's all by himself. He's a hermit, kind of. But still, he's true to the original. Actually, he's better. I got to say, I enjoyed him better in this movie than in the first one. Despite being 30 years older, he's got so much more panache.
He's got a little bit more personality, too.
This time.
Which I think maybe it's because it's 30 years on and so much has happened. But he felt like a more... just like a better, well-rounded character. Like, he's lived a lot more life.
Yeah. And that scene he has with Jared Leto is so powerful. It's one of Harrison Ford's most powerful scenes, the I Know What's Real. And I love how this movie complements the first one, and it doesn't try to rewrite history. It does, in a sense, add to a history that could have potentially been there. It doesn't feel like a retcon. And I like that it respects both camps that felt... like, Deckard was a replicant and the camp that felt like he wasn't.
Right.
I like that this movie doesn't outright come out and say, okay, the debates can stop.
They know? Don't, yeah.
Like, the director, the writer, they don't come out and say, well, you know, it's our movie. We get to do what we want and we're going to put our mark on it. We're going to put our stamp. And forever and ever, Deckard is a replicant or isn't. It takes a lot of restraint to say, could be, maybe not.
Right.
Maybe not.
They basically said, like, the information that you're carrying into this is the information.
They continue to play with you, and they give you more stuff to play with. Is he? Isn't he? The whole, I know it's real, but he doesn't sound like he's sure. You know, I thought that was fantastic. Really handled well. And Ryan Gosling, excellent. Excellent. This is like Ryan Gosling's movie. He carries this movie. I mean, you know, we've already established in my review of Blade Runner that I can finish a movie, I can sort of enjoy it with nobody carrying the movie on their back.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, Ford definitely should have been, but I didn't feel he did in the first movie. But this is Gosling's movie. He makes, you know, I want to say the cliche of he makes this movie work. He doesn't. This movie would work regardless of what he's doing.
Right.
But it's so much better because of what he brings to the character of Kay. He's not trying to be a badass. He's not walking around with a swagger and
yeah,
don't mess with me. He's such a nice guy. He's just a nice guy. I mean, in a crap situation, who's constantly crapped on. They hate him. This is great sci-fi in the Gene Roddenberry sense, where Roddenberry with his early Star Trek stories would tell stories he wouldn't be allowed to tell in his age. But if you put him in space with aliens, then you can tell these stories about racism and mm-hmm. all those other social issues. And that's what Blade Runner is. This feels more like Philip K. Dick than Blade Runner right. did. The new Blade Runner does.
I like how it does show us, you know, we were so used to the original Blade Runner. We have to kill all the replicants. And seeing where society is 30 years on, where there are many replicants out there, and how they are sort of frowned upon or how they integrate into society, and how even a lonely Blade Runner who's a replicant, his only sort of refuge is this computer woman at home. And it's so weird that a machine is finding love with another machine, and it's these interesting sci-fi ideas that they explore and the way they work those themes into the story and memory and what is real and all that stuff is just kind of fascinating.
So the first movie tried to do that with a human falling in love with a replicant. Didn't work because of Ford's performance. I guess they didn't like each other, the actor and the actress.
Oh, yeah, Sean Young.
They used to call them their hate scenes. Yeah, they're doing a hate scene. And also, this whole idea of Deckard possibly being a replicant. I'm like, what? So you've got this relationship that doesn't really have any genuine heart to it.
Mm-hmm.
And it might be a human and a replicant. It might be a replicant and a replicant. It just doesn't work. It doesn't make you wonder. 2049, though, is classic Philip K. Dick, in that you got the replicant and the computer program have the most genuine,
right,
heartfelt relationship in the movie, filled with a bunch of asshole humans. They're racists, they're jerks, they're idiots,
yeah,
they're lazy, they're just the scum. And Jared Leto's character, Wallace, is the biggest scum.
Piece of crap.
And he's human, right? And he doesn't even get his comeuppance in the end. So that's the Philip K. Dick style of story, where you don't get a happy ending, but you don't get a depressing ending. You get just, the world kind of sucks, but it doesn't make me that sad.
Right.
You know, he's got a different view of it that's not all that depressing. That's what I appreciate about Philip K. Dick stories. And that's what I appreciate about this movie. They weren't just making a movie that has to be so much like Blade Runner. They were making a movie that has to be a genuine Philip K. Dick story.
Mm-hmm. And they found a way to sort of get in the prerequisites for being a Blade Runner movie. The movie basically opens with him hunting down a replicant.
That was an unfilmed scene from the first movie.
That's how
the first movie was supposed to start.
And that scene was a great scene. Dave Bautista, really physical battle they have.
I stand corrected. I remember in years gone by saying Bautista was the poor man's Rock. And I love him in Guardians of the Galaxy, but in the short that he did and in this film, I'm blown away by his talent. He is fantastic. And so minimalist, too.
Very minimalist, but it works.
Yeah, fantastic.
It works so well, and he still has that presence even when it's very reserved. And I do like that they bring back like Edward James Olmos for a scene, and we hit
those moments,
but it doesn't feel like just fan service. Like it feels in service of the story, and it all somehow works. And we still do get a lot of, you know, Ryan Gosling is doing research, just like Harrison Ford would do research.
Yeah.
But obviously with today's tools, they present it in a bit more of a dynamic way.
He doesn't sit there zooming in, punching in on something for 75 minutes.
And we still have, you know, something similar to like the first movie where this one has the wooden horse and this iconography that just makes it feel like a lived in world that we're still in that same space, even though it's in the future.
Yeah, and I like the little details they threw in there that this is what would have been the continuation of the first Blade Runner, not the continuation of our world.
Right.
So you still see Atari signs everywhere because Atari was prominently featured in the first movie. And the visuals in here are an evolution of the Blade Runner technology signs and all that stuff, not of our world.
Yeah. Very comprehensive. So let's do best part.
Worst part.
I'm going to say best part. This movie, it could be almost all best part because, like I said, the visuals, the music, Gosling, Ford, it all comes together in such a way.
I never thought I'd hear best part Gosling. But it's true.
But it's true. And I think that just best part
we
is...
We can bust his balls because he's from up the road in London, Ontario. Yeah. We love you, Gos.
I think that, you know, they found a way to make a sequel that felt organic, stayed true, and revered the first one without being so shackled to it that they couldn't do anything that felt new. And that is such a hard thing to do. And they really nailed it. Denis Villeneuve is proving to be one of the most interesting and well-rounded directors because he's making all these different types of movies, and I love the guy and can't wait to see what he does next. Worst part...
He's doing Dune.
I'm not excited for Dune, but I'm excited for Denis Villeneuve's Dune.
He's going to base it off the book, not off the first movie.
Worst part... As much as this movie isn't boring to me, I would shave off 20 minutes.
You could.
245 is a stretch. If this was 2.5, I think it probably would have also done better. There's a little chunk in the middle before we get to Ford where I'm just like, we just need to pick up the pace just a bit. But outside of that little bit of length, I love a lot of this movie.
I found the movie to be so immersive. It could have been 8 hours and I wouldn't have... I'm just in it, and I love being in that world. I love being in worlds like this, these dystopian or post-apocalyptic environments. That's why like an 8-hour Mad Max movie would not feel any different to me than a 2-hour one. And this, like I said, felt so much more genuine to Philip K. Dick than even the first one. And this one is as beautiful and stunning visually as the first one. And the music is great. Yeah, you could shave it down, but I don't really look at this as a typical movie that you need to hit the beats. This movie flies in the face of typical filmmaking.
It does.
It doesn't give a crap about the beats and the corporate checklist and stuff. It wipes its butt of all that stuff, just like I wipe my butt of idiot movie fans who like to share ignorant comments and feel a sense of accomplishment. So, it could have been another hour long and I would have been like, awesome, I get to be in this world more. Worst part for me, I kind of wondered if I would say Wallace not getting his comeuppance.
Mm-hmm.
But it's not like he's skipping down the road going, la la la, I got away with it. It was just something that my wife and I mentioned. I think she mentioned it an hour or two after the movie. Hey, he never got anything, to pay for what he did. He's a scumbag and he got away with it. And I thought, well, I guess if it took that long to bother us, then it's really not that depressing and there's nothing really that wrong with it. I have a hard time really coming up with anything bad for this movie because it was so immersive and I enjoyed it so much.
Mm-hmm.
But like I said, it's a different experience. It wasn't like a great movie with a great story beginning, middle, end. I just loved experiencing it. There aren't a lot of movies I experience.
Right.
The last movie I think that I experienced like this was Tron Legacy. Just in it and feeling it. Living through the people in the movie instead of just watching them and being entertained. So that's why it's really hard to find a worst part.
Yep.
But the best part, again, hard to find a best part for this. Everything works so well. But it's got to be visuals?
Off the charts.
Gosling, music, we've already said it. The use of Ford, everything. Everything is fantastic. Replay value, can I throw that out too?
Yeah.
I've seen it again and I loved it just as much the second time. So best part is it's a masterpiece.
Yeah.
Finally, like another masterpiece was created that I can watch every year or two and enjoy it. So yeah, great movie.
That's Blade Runner 2049 on Blu-ray, digital, all that stuff now. So if you've been waiting, we spoiled the hell out of it. So hopefully you haven't been waiting, but check it out.
It's an intellectual movie. So if you're smart, check it out. If you're an idiot, go Don't. Watch a Marvel movie. Thanks for watching it. Until next time.
Enjoy the show.